Amen. We're going to turn again in God's word to 1 Timothy and 1 Timothy chapter 5. So we're continuing this section on the widows, and I'm seeking to draw out application beyond just the obvious. We'd have several, I suppose, quite far removed sermons if we simply focused on the practical administration of help to widows. But we come in this section to now verse 9. And I trust that God will encourage and challenge us as we consider these words. So just briefly, I'll pray and then I'll read. Lord, we pray that you would do just that, that your word would have effect amongst us, that we would be challenged where that's needed and also encouraged. We pray that we would not be conformed to this world, but that our minds would be transformed through the wisdom of Christ. Help us, O Lord, to humbly submit to what you have given, and forgive us for errors in our thought. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Do not let a widow under 60 years old be taken into the number, and not unless she has been the wife of one man, well reported for good works, if she has brought up children, if she has lodged strangers, if she has washed the saints' feet, if she has relieved the afflicted, if she has diligently followed every good work. Amen. I watched a documentary some time ago. I can't remember what it was. But there'd been a wildfire, and it had destroyed a number of homes. And the person who was making the documentary walked down the fire destroyed street, and there were people digging around in the rubble of their homes. Why were they doing that? Well, they were looking for something that would remind them of the life they once had, something of the life that they had lived. And the end of our days will be like that. God will test our lives, and he will test our works, and everything that is vanity will be burned up and will go to nothing. But the things that God esteems, they'll be preserved and they'll be accounted and they'll be put on display, and they'll be rewarded by God, who will pronounce upon us those wonderful words, "Well done, thy good and faithful servant." And the question to ask tonight is, what will remain of your life? What is valuable before the Lord? Now, I won't make any apology for focusing my attention on women tonight, given that it's women that are before us. But hopefully, as we think about godly womanhood, we'll at least all of us have something to take away, some opportunity to reflect on this question for our own lives. So the sermon's title is Godly Womanhood. We're in the middle here of this section on widows, and I've said so far that one of the reasons you have such a long portion of this letter given over to the subject is a testimony to God's own heart for the most vulnerable. He really wants to make sure that those in need receive the help that they need. And he's ordained both the family and the family first to care for the vulnerable, and then the church. And one of the things that he's conscious of here is protecting the reputation of the church, because the reputation of the church is tied to the reputation of our Lord. And he's begun to give the positive instruction for which widows should be brought into the care of the church. The last time we were here, we said the first test is this: one who could be stripped of everything and yet be found hoping in the Lord. And that was contrasted with the woman who chooses to live in pleasure. The godly woman can have everything taken away, and she is found night and day with supplications before the Lord. But the other positive test is given to us here, and it is an evaluation of her life. A widow must not be taken under 60 years old into the number, and not unless she has been the wife of one man, well reported for good works. If she has brought up children, if she has lodged strangers, if she has washed the saints' feet, if she has relieved the afflicted, if she has diligently followed every good work. Now, why does she need to be over the age of 60? Well, in part, this is in the spirit of not overburdening the church. There's a practical dimension to it. Paul says in verse 14 that he desires that younger women should marry, and the provision of family will be there to care for her. I don't think there's a hard and fast rule here, by the way. I don't think Paul would turf anybody out who is in real need of help, but it is a practical consideration. The other part to it, though, is about, again, the reputation of the church. He's going to warn a second time about women who behave in shameful ways. In verse 11, he talks about younger women who begin to grow wanton of Christ. And the concern is, if you bring a woman who doesn't have a good reputation into the care of the church, and she is associated with the body of Christ, and then goes out and lives shamefully, she will bring shame on the name of Christ, and she will damage the gospel reputation of that church. And here's the advantage of a woman being at least 60 years old. Her life can be looked back on for fruit. And that's what Paul does. He gives Timothy a measure of godly womanhood. And we have an opportunity then to ask ourselves this question: what is it that a godly woman looks like? And what are the kind of works that will withstand the fire at the end of time? So I'm going to go through these. The first is that she is to be faithful to her husband. Verse 9, do not let a widow under 60 years be taken into the number, and not unless she has been the wife of one man. The Lord Jesus Christ was faithful to his Father's calling. His faithfulness is the cause of our redemption, and God seeks within all of his people faithfulness. One of the things we've already said is that the first sphere of responsibility where we demonstrate faithfulness to God is the family. Godliness is first tested, is first practiced in the home with those given to our immediate care. And there is a logical priority on the marriage, because the marriage is the fountainhead of all family. And so the first test of godliness is whether, and it was the same actually for elders, whether a husband is faithful to his wife and whether a wife is faithful to her husband. We live in an age where women are made to feel insecure and inadequate. And I know that Anna struggles with this, and we hear about those outside of the church struggling with this. All kinds of comparisons are made as to what a woman should be, about what is valuable about a woman, what is to be esteemed about a woman. But here is a wonderful release from the burden of the world. If you can be faithful as a wife, your life already is regarded well by the Lord. If you can be faithful to your husband, if you can be faithful, you husbands, to your wives, you've made great progress with the Lord. She's also a second mark of godliness, to be one who raises children. She's to have a reputation for good works, and first on the list is if she has brought up children. Now, does Paul mean here that she simply has had children, managed to get them to adulthood? No. There's certainly something useful to society in general about having children and getting them to adulthood, but that's not it. And we know where Paul's focus is because he recalls, as he writes to Timothy in the second letter, Timothy's own family background. Do you remember 2 Timothy chapter 1 and verse 3? He says, I thank God whom I serve with a pure conscience, as my forefathers did, as without ceasing, I remember you in my prayers night and day, greatly desiring to see you, being mindful of your tears, that I may be filled with joy when I call to remembrance the genuine faith that is in you, which dwelt first in your grandmother Lois and your mother Eunice, and I am persuaded is also in you. He's not just commending the raising of children to women in general. What he is commending is the self-sacrificial acts of motherhood that not only raise a child to be naturally healthy, to be naturally provided for, but one who invests in the spiritual life of the child. This is the way that God has built his church down through the generations, and the bulk of this responsibility has ordinarily been given to women. Were it not for the godly grandmother and the godly mother that Timothy had, we would not have a Timothy in the church. Were it not for the godly, self-sacrificial motherhood of Mary, we would not have a Savior as we have him today. God had ordained her motherhood in the instruction of that child. If a man is to work by the sweat of his brow, a woman is given a work similar to this, and it is in the raising of children. And it is incredibly hard work. For any of you who've already been through the process, I don't need to tell you. For those who are going through it, I don't need to remind you. It is an incredibly demanding thing. And you will begin to ask yourself, and you'll have asked yourself this many times, is it worth it? You've looked at the lives of others who are carefree, who don't have this responsibility. And you ask, why put myself through it? Why put my family through it? Well, let me give you three reasons why. Because number one, you are following the example of the Lord Jesus Christ. What is it he did in his own lifetime? He raised up children for his father. In his own work of redemption, in his own self-denial, in his instruction and in his self-giving, he was preparing sons and daughters to the glory of his father. You follow in that same example as you raise children. You are also contributing to the church of the future. There is something incredibly fitting about this, that a woman who invests in the church of the future should, when her time comes, be cared for by the church who has become the church of the present. And then, and you have this thought always, nobody really appreciates what I'm doing. Nobody sees what I'm doing. Nobody appreciates it. But here is the great encouragement that the Lord appreciates it. And the Lord takes note. Here is the mark. What does he say to Timothy as he brings these widows into the care of the church? Does he say, I want you to select good entrepreneurs, people who can, you know, generate a bit of income for the church? No. He says, women of God are marked by these qualities, faithful to their husband, and they have raised children. These are the things that are valuable to God. Number three, hospitality. If she has lodged strangers, hospitality is essential to the kingdom of God. Our Lord's ministry would not have continued, for he had nowhere to lay his head, had it not been for people opening their homes, the burden of which again falls to women. The church would have had no place to worship had it not been for the opening up of homes to facilitate that worship, the burden of which fell to women. The gospel would not have spread. Traveling missionaries would have had no place to stay had it not been for the opening up of homes. One of the attitudes you hear in the church today is to complain about women's roles. Christian women, Christian men are angry about it. If they get any whiff that you're something of a reformed Christian who believe there's a distinction between men and women and a distinction in roles, they get hot under the collar. Why shouldn't a woman be in the eldership? Why shouldn't a woman be preaching? Why shouldn't a woman administer the sacraments? Because God has said this is not what I've appointed for them. But what he has appointed for women, it's not an overstatement to say this, that through the service of women embracing their roles, the church has been built.
Yes, right.
Through faithful wives, the raising of godly seed, and the opening of homes, the church of Jesus Christ has been built. Not in their assuming the roles given to men, but in their embracing of the roles that God has given to them. The mystery is why women would want to demean what God has said is noble and honorable. He has appointed it this way. And the work of being a mother, the work of hospitality is hard enough without constantly living with the feeling that you're inadequate and that you could be doing something that is better. But it is completely liberating to embrace God's standards and to know that all of those years that you have given up in service of your family have not been wasted. And it's these things that God will remember for all eternity. She's faithful to her husband, the raising of children, hospitality. And then number four, the caring for the body of Christ. If she has washed the saints' feet. And here the focus moves from the home to the life of the body. A godly woman with the qualities that God has given to her becomes something of a mother and a wife within the church. Imagine the church without women. All of the things that are done and that we don't take note of and we don't give due credit for. The preparation of the sacrament. Who is it that bakes the bread so that we can come to the Lord's table? It's Anna. But in other churches, it's other wives. Who is it that prepares the tea and coffee so that fellowship can be had? Who sets the tables? Who facilitates fellowship over a meal? It's the women of the church. And I know that when you say these things, and even as I say them now, it feels as though these are trivial things to attribute to women, as though a woman is only good to serve a cup of tea or a cup of coffee, but we shouldn't trivialize them. No. Listening to what Mark says as he pays tribute to these so-called trivial acts. Mark 15 and verse 40. There were also women looking on from afar, among whom were Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James the Less, and Joses and Salome, who also followed him and ministered to him when he was in Galilee, and many other women who came with him to Jerusalem. These women were serving Christ. How were they serving him in his ministry? Probably by bringing him food, probably by washing his clothes. And women are given this role of caregiver within the church. As we read in John 13, in this they take on the role of Christ. Christ himself lowered himself to the place of servant and washed his disciples' feet. For women who give themselves to facilitating the life of the church quietly in the background, they're doing one of the most honorable and noble things that could be done. Not taking credit to themselves, but embracing the role of Christ, allowing the church to continue, enabling the church to feel like a family, creating an environment of love. She's faithful to her husband. She's raised children. She's hospitable. She's caring for the body of Christ. And then the fifth and final quality is that she is a nurse to those in need. She has relieved the afflicted. The godly woman, wherever help is needed, is moved with compassion and seeks to minister to that particular need. Now, everybody should be empathetic, but it is especially by God's design, and he has imprinted it on women to be empathetic, to be nurses, to be natural nurses. God refers to this twice, once in the Old Testament, Isaiah 66 and verse 13, when he likens his own motherly care of Israel to what is natural to a mother, a human mother. Isaiah 66 in verse 13, as one whom his mother comforts, so I will comfort you, and you shall be comforted in Jerusalem. The other comes about when Jesus approaches Jerusalem and he laments over Jerusalem and he says, how I wanted to gather you together as a hen gathers her chicks under its wings. God is affirming there is something natural in women that makes them fit to be nurses, makes them fit to be caregivers. Those texts also reveal to us that those qualities are the qualities of divinity. Yes. I've said it many times before, but the image of God is not found in man and man alone, or in woman and woman alone, but the image of God is found in man and woman complementing each other. Women, you should know this, that when the fire comes, it's not wealth, it's not independence, it's not titles, it's not worldly accolades, but it is compassionate acts of mercy that will be remembered by God. These are the things that God values. Faithfulness in marriage, the raising of children, hospitality, caring for the body, and a nurse to those in need. Now, please don't misunderstand me as saying that this is a rigid and exhaustive list, and that nothing else in your life matters. It absolutely does. He says at the end there that she has diligently followed every good work, but what I am saying is that these are the headlines of godly womanhood. Why is it important to say this? Because we live in a culture that is antithetical to God's design for man and for women. We're made to feel as though everything that I've just described is some kind of barbaric remnant of the past. And our society would be better if we just got rid of it altogether. And women, you would be better off if you simply could be like the men whose shadow you've been forced to live under over all of these terrible centuries. But you know, the reality is that most women naturally, though our society has been poisoned by an aggressive feminism, most women naturally lean towards all that I've just described. And then on top of that, they continue to try and do the role of a man. On top of that, as hard as it is, they're made to feel like it's a worthless, a meaningless work. But it's not that at all. You shouldn't let the world rob you of your dignity and of your joy. Don't allow the world to shape the way you think about how you should live and how you should serve, but allow God's word. And here he's very clear in giving those headline summaries, and I would encourage you all to, you women, to embrace godly femininity, knowing that you are the unsung heroes of Christendom. I would encourage you to aspire to these things and to cultivate a respect for them amongst your friends, amongst your daughters, if you have them, amongst those you talk to. It's an amazing thing how many times we meet somebody and they ask Anna, what do you do? And they can see she has three children. And most of them, if they know her even a little bit, can see that she has people in the home all of the time. And yet they still ask that question as though it's just assumed that's not a work. It's not valuable and she should be doing something else. It's a preposterous idea to embrace motherhood, to embrace being a faithful wife is more than a full-time job. To open your home, to serve the body of Christ, to facilitate the growth of the church, to care for the body, to be a nurse to those in need is more than a full-time job. And we should work hard to cultivate a respect for these things and those we talk to and the way that we talk about it. It's God-honoring. You should be happy to know that God has given you, yes, a very difficult task, but something that is of eternal value. Now, for all of us, what are we to take away from a sermon like this? And for those of you, and where the ship has sailed, and maybe you're over 60 and you got a lot of this wrong in the past. Well, what then? Well, I want us just very briefly to take a moment to contemplate God's priorities for our lives. We've been through some of the priorities for women. Our conscience and what we already know from God's word will speak to the priorities that he's given to us as men. But I want us just to stop and to ask ourselves the question, when Christ returns and your life is tested, what is it that will remain? What is it that he's going to look upon and be pleased with? And so just take a moment now to quietly reflect between you and God, listening to your conscience, listening to what you know from God's word, to be the priorities that he has given to you, and ask yourself the question, how will my life be evaluated? Am I living for God's glory? So just take a moment now and reflect on that question. I hope as you think over that, you're able to see that there is much in your life that will withstand the fire, and that one day you will hear the words, "Well done, good and faithful servant. You were faithful over a few things. I will make you ruler over many things. Enter into the joy of your Lord." May you all hear those words. And where you felt as though you've falling below that standard, where you've missed opportunities, then just hear again as we close the hope of the gospel. Our Lord told this story. Two men went up to the temple to pray, one a Pharisee and the other a tax collector. The Pharisee stood and prayed thus within himself, "God, I thank you that I am not like other men, extortioners, unjust, adulterers, or even as this tax collector. I fast twice a week. I give tithes of all I possess." And the tax collector, standing afar off, would not so much as raise his eyes to heaven, but beat his breast, saying, "God, be merciful to me, a sinner." And I tell you, this man went down to his house justified rather than the other. It can be uncomfortable to hear about things later on in life where we may have made mistakes in the past. And we can carry a heavy conscience. But you should know this, that so long as you can pray as this man did, "God, be merciful to me, a sinner," you are assured that you've been justified by God. That man went down to his house justified. And where there is conviction, know that God has pardon and mercy abundant to forgive. And then repent, and with the little time that you have left in your pilgrimage on this earth, invest in living well to God, as a Christian, as a man, as a woman, to his glory. Amen.